And in this case, it's more important that you hear me rather than see me because I'm very short. And I'm sure it has something to do with nutrition. So I was born in India and was a child that was completely spoiled by my parents in the kind of food I ate before I left for the US when there was no such fondling, spoiling, etc. And I became more healthy. So I'm going to speak about food policy and nutrition. I have to first emphasize that I'm not a nutritionist and I'm not an expert on nutrition. I am an agricultural economist, and learning about nutrition has been late in my life. And one thing that has struck me very much as an economist that has worked on many other fields is the immense complexity of nutrition. I'm totally overwhelmed by how complex the topic is. There are a few others, like water management, for instance, on which I've also worked, which is equally complex. But it's the complexity that strikes me. And the SDG 1 and 2 I'm going to mention because reducing poverty is very important. But one of the points I'm going to make is that we've learned over time that reducing poverty doesn't necessarily lead to improved nutrition. And we need to do much more research in that area. Looking at SDGs, one is also struck as an outsider that obesity is basically missing in action. It is in the WHO's targets, but in SDG 2, there really is not that much emphasis on obesity. Now, there are large number of issues which are related to the solutions to the problem, and I'm not going to deal with any one of them. So I've just listed some of the many, many solutions to the nutrition problem. The time is very limited, so I'm just going to outline the problem as I see it, the challenge as I see it, from the perspective of an economist who doesn't know much about nutrition. So FAO's latest estimate suggests that the incidence of hunger has increased, and it's because hunger measured mainly as calorie deficiencies. And FAO says that the increase, the change in the reversal in the trend is because of two main factors: climate change, which India is very badly affected by it, as are many tropical African countries, and conflict, which has increased a lot in many other countries. And now, increasingly, there are multiple measures of hunger and malnutrition. These are some of the few. And I'm not going to read them, list them, but they are there. The last item, which is women's role, I'm going to have something to say about it, because it's very striking that despite their critical role, it is not paid as much attention to in improving nutrition as I would like to see, particularly in countries like India. So the concept of food security and nutrition has been evolving very rapidly. And when I first started my career in agricultural economics, the focus was very much on food security as determined or defined by FAO and macroeconomists. So it was about food availability, as several people have mentioned. There was mention of food access, but much less attention to it until Amartya Sen began to emphasize the importance of access. Food utilization, which has received relatively little attention, but now people have started talking about the importance of water, sanitation, etc. And food stability, which was an issue which is now becoming again very important because of climate change, much more so in countries that don't have the kind of large stocks and surpluses that India does. So the focus has shifted, as Anne so eloquently pointed out, from focus on cereals to focus on diversity and production diversity. But there are huge challenges in that area, achieving production diversity and seeing to it that it influences diet diversity. UNICEF's work was very unique in 1919, identifying the problem of nutrition in a very different way, with a substantial focus on women and children. And as somebody who's worked in as an agricultural economist, I was impressed to see that the FAO framework that I pointed out earlier and the nutrition framework were for a long time two different frameworks. They were not being integrated. So one of the things that once I began to work on nutrition, I began to do was to just list all the factors that affect nutrition. And basically, I see that the economists have dealt with supply and demand of food, and not even on composition often. And nutritionists have dealt with nutrition as direct interventions and indirect interventions. And somewhere they coincide. But then there are these lists of number of outcomes of the result of supply and demand as well as direct and indirect interventions. I'm sorry, it's unreadable because the number of factors that seem to influence nutrition are so large. I just wanted to impress upon you what I learned by doing this research on the complexity of nutrition. Others have looked at nutrition in a different way, looking at it as the role of the individual household, markets and countries. And the earlier framework I pointed out interacts with this framework in some complex way. So we know from WHO's reports that there is still a long road ahead to achieve the 2025 and 2030 targets and on stunting and wasting and overweight and breastfeeding, etc. And India looms very large in many of those targets that need to be achieved. So these are the data on reduction of hunger as defined by FAO, basically as calorie gap. And you can see that South Asia is very high in terms of the number of people, and Africa very high when it comes to the prevalence percentage of people. What is striking to me as an economist is that the World Bank declared in 2010 that poverty has been eradicated from the world. And these numbers show how poverty has been eradicated in different parts of the world. But although that has been the case, the general view, if one looks at the projections for 2030, is that there is one part of the world that is not going to be able to succeed in reducing poverty, and that is Africa. In India's case, India is making great progress on reducing poverty, but not on reducing undernutrition and multidimensional poverty. And you can see there is a high correlation between the two, but not perfect, because there are many countries in the world, including India, where multidimensional poverty is very strong. And that is where the relationship between child stunting and multidimensional poverty is significant. And that is why we need to look at variables beyond just calories or even micronutrient deficiencies to look at other variables that influence nutrition. Barry Popkin, I'm sure all of you know of him. He is one of my heroes, who's done a lot of work on obesity. And he's pointing out that the growth in obesity is becoming a very significant factor. He started writing about it in 1970s, and it's only now that people have begun to pay attention to obesity. So if we look at food security, then not just as income poverty related, but multidimensional, and also transition in a highly dynamic situation of income growth, urbanization, population growth, etc., then the concept of nutrition transition is very important. And nutritionists need to understand how transitions take place when populations urbanize and their preferences in consumption change, etc. Popkin emphasizes that dietary behavior and changes in low and middle income countries are very important. But they also have different consequences. For instance, BMI doesn't by itself tell you that people are more obese unless you measure their waist circumference. If that is the case, then we are going to have to need new measures of nutrition insecurity and transitions than is the case now. So obesity prevalence, if we look at it, where is it growing the most? Americas, both North and South America, have some of the highest incidence of obesity. And as an Indian who lives in America, it's my wish that Indians don't follow the pattern of Americans in changing, as many Chinese are doing, very rapid consumption of meat and meat products, etc. It's important that India maintains the vegetarian diet, which is balanced. Also, it's much more benign to the environment, but also it causes much less obesity than is the case. And once we begin to understand what are the underlying factors in obesity, you realize that it's the foreign direct investment, it's supermarkets, it's the sodas and all sorts of new ways of consumption that is leading to obesity. So this graph shows where South Asia is in relation to its income and consumption compared to North America and Europe. And you can see that large number of calories as income increases is not necessarily the way to deal with obesity. Another thing that I found striking is not only is the obesity high among women, so undernourishment is high among women, but obesity is also high among women. And it's in two parts of the world, in the North, in the Middle East and in North America, and in Chile and South American countries. So South American countries have become very concerned about the rapid growth in obesity, not just among adults, but also among children. And they are forming a lot of regulations. I'm going to skip that slide. In case of Mexico, for instance, where it's become almost an epidemic of obesity, and many of the economists are relating it to NAFTA and changing consumption patterns, changing cost of labor, changing economics of domestic consumption, production by women of cooking at home compared to going and buying food in the market. All those factors have caused the problem of obesity in Mexico, as well as in Chile and other countries. So Latin American countries in that sense are ahead of us because they're becoming obese more rapidly, but they're also introducing number of regulations from which India can learn. So I think I'll end my presentation by saying there are cross-country experiences of both how to and how not to deal with the nutrition problem. And I hope that India will learn from both of those. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr.